rendition of the National Anthem. Let's begin tonight by taking a moment of silence for the victims, the families, and all those affected by the tragedy in Los Angeles. Thank you. And as we also think about Las Vegas, let's continue to send support to the people that need it in Puerto Rico, and Florida, and Texas as they continue to recover. The city is moving in the right direction. And if we continue our collaboration and successful job growth policies, a year from this date, Cincinnati will be even better than it is today. The state of our city is growing stronger. Our job growth policies are working. Just released government reports rank our regional economy as the largest in Ohio, surpassing Columbus and Cleveland for the first time. In just 1 year, Kroger has announced the first downtown grocery store in 40 years, with a $90 million building to go on top. Skyhouse is building a $90 million project on the river, and Children's Hospital is committed to the single largest investment in the city ever, with a $550 million expansion in Annandale. Over the next 12 months, $1 billion in new permits will be issued, shattering all previous records of $732 million in 2015. This success would not be possible without the help of a lot of people. But I'd like to say a special thanks this evening to Oscar Padilla, our outgoing Director of Economic Development. Let's give Oscar a round of applause. We saw the police force down by 150 cops and crime was up. Our roads and bridges were crumbling, our credit had been downgraded, our budget wasn't balanced, and we faced a bankruptcy because of the pension crisis. People believe that City Hall put pet projects over neighborhoods. But over the past 4 years, we have rebuilt the city's foundations. And of course, we are prioritizing safety first. Under the leadership of our great police chief, Elliot Isaac, shootings are down 2 years in a row, despite the tragic violence at Cameo earlier this year that broke the single day record of mass shooting in Cincinnati. That's incredible. Coming off one of the best years in a decade, 2016, to be able to recover from an incident like that and still see a reduction is nothing short of a miracle. Let's give our police department a round of applause. Councilmember Christopher Smitherman's leadership as chair of the Law and Public Safety has been vital to our success. And he has really led on the issue of supporting our first responders and making the city safer, especially in the aftermath. Let's give him a round of applause. To continue this trend, we are deploying a hard and soft, comprehensive approach to crime. We have and will add cops to the streets, and we have implemented ShotSpotter and HotSpot enforcement areas. This state-of-the-art technology helps police immediately locate gunfire and respond to shootings as quickly as possible, giving our cops more tools to reduce violence. I also joined the Mayors Against Illegal Guns, and we joined with Citizens on Patrol, Moms Demand Action, and mothers of shooting victims who understand the consequences, personally, of losing a child to violence. And we continue to collaborate with the U.S. Attorney, the FBI, the ATF, the county to target repeat violent offenders. We are doing this while also protecting civil rights and investing in community relations. The collaborative agreement cultivated our city's progressive approach to civil rights and police-community relations. Our community-oriented policing reforms have served as a nationwide model, but there is always room for improvement, which is why I called last year for this agreement to be refreshed. The importance of engaging in community dialogue and providing a safe place to share our hopes, fears, angers, and concerns is necessary to continue to make progress as an inclusive city. The collaborative agreement united those who once stood on opposite sides, and we will continue our work to strengthen police community. We will keep listening. We will keep learning. We will continue to move forward. We have also hired Saul Marine, who was the court-appointed monitor of our police department, to come back to review our approach to police community relations and make recommendations on how we can improve. And of course, we are also investing in outreach and utilizing the Partner Center to work with the community. Despite all this good work, our city's safety, as well as our country's safety, is hurt by the continuing, ongoing health epidemic of the heroin drug addiction. And nobody is more on the front lines of this battle than our firefighters. Under the leadership of the great Chief Roy Winston, a 29-year veteran who was recently named our Chief 17th Fire Chief, let's give him a round of applause. People day after day who have overdosed and need addiction services. It's a tough job. A person's life depends on it every time they go out on a dark hand run. It's emotionally taxing for them, but they continue working every day to save the lives of those addicted to heroin. And in honor of that sacrifice that our firefighters provide every day, I am awarding the annual Humanitarian of the Year Award to firefighter Lieutenant John Williams. Lieutenant Williams is a leader of our quick response team pilot, which has successfully placed dozens of overdose victims into treatment programs. Thank you, Lieutenant Williams, for your commitment to this issue and of saving lives. Firefighters like Lieutenant Williams, drug addicts, and families who have suffered from the crisis deserve a plan to help those that need it, but also to help bring an end to this epidemic. That's why we are taking bold steps. We are working with the Hamilton County Heroin Task Force, headed by the great County Commissioner Denise Treehouse and Councilmember P.G. Sittenfeld, who at City Hall has been a tireless voice on the issue battling the heroin and other drug addictions. And to do this, we have recently expanded 24/7 hotline. This partnership has also led us to participate in a pilot study that will supply tens of thousands of doses of Narcan at no cost to the city to citizens. At the city, we have trained community members on how to use Narcan and created a program to help those get the recovery services they need. And in this year's budget, council members Chris Seelbach and Wendell Young, and let's pause for a minute to send our prayers and thoughts to Wendell Young on his recovery from surgery recently. We know he will recover. Let's give them a round of applause. They led the effort to fund fund a needle exchange program to prevent the spread of disease. I also want to extend our thoughts and prayers. Well, I just said that about when we got through. No, I'm not reading this. It's all on the top of my head. This summer, under the leadership of City Solicitor Paul Bugs, we think we have filed a lawsuit to hold accountable the companies responsible for dumping millions of dollars of prescription opioids into our community. The companies we sued are $400 billion in annual revenue. They control 80% of the market. But most importantly, they have already pled guilty to purposely marketing drugs that they knew to be addictive. And they have paid hundreds of millions of dollars to the federal government in fines. But we have not been reimbursed. You, the taxpayer, have not been reimbursed for the Narcan, the beds we're paying for, and all the effort we put into this. We deserve to be reimbursed from these companies, for the Narcan, for the service runs, for the treatment programs, even if we receive that reimbursement, we'll never scratch the surface of the value of lost lives and broken families. We must also address the root cause and change the way these drugs are prescribed before people get addicted. The CDC, the Center for Disease Control, has reported that 80% of heroin users started with painkillers. It's an amazing statistic. And 1 in 3 who take OxyContin for 31 days will be addicted. 1 in 3. That are terrible odds for something that you take believing it will do you good. I'm proud to report that the Ohio Mayor's Alliance, a bipartisan coalition of mayors of Ohio's 30 most populated cities, an organization that I helped start, is working with Governor Kasich on changing these practices. The state has already taken steps to reduce the overall prescription of opioids. Since 2012, in Hamilton County, opioid prescriptions have fallen by 20% and continue to decline. So we are making progress, but there is so much more to do. Just as we have rebuilt the strength of our sworn force, we have also, under the leadership of the great city manager, Harry Black, rebuilt our city's finances. Let's give the city manager a call. Literally nothing is more foundational than our city's financial credit. When I took office, the city faced an $800 million pension liability, and we've been downgraded by rating agencies. Within 3 years, we shored up the pension, balanced a budget, and earned an upgrade to our credit. As budget chairman, Charlie Winburn helped to guide council to pass 4 structurally balanced budgets in a row. Thank you, Mr. Winburn. We have built a city that not only is solvent, but is committed to customer service. We measure everything we do, and we are trying hard and have the measurements to prove that we are serving you better. Under the leadership of the city manager and Lee Tammy, we have embraced performance management and data analytics. As the city's chief performance officer, Lee Tammy has led the office to greatly expand its scope and capabilities. Over the last year, this team saved measurably $3.3 million in tax money, using data to ensure that every dollar is spent efficiently. The CincyStat program holds department directors accountable to the taxpayers by ensuring that we are providing results-driven service. In April 2017, 75% of surveyed constituents were satisfied with how customer service requests were handled. This was a 10% increase from the previous measurement a year before. Previously, many departments worked in silos and didn't speak to one another about their problems. But now, our innovation lab, which is literally a room where people come together, we bring together department heads and members of different departments talking to each other to collaborate and solve important issues. And most importantly, they are making Cincinnati a national leader in government transparency. Through Cincy Insights, you can go to our website and see the data we use to make decisions about your dollars. You can now track snowplows during winter weather events, see police calls, and street sweepers and trash vehicle travels, and you can see this all in real time. It is for all of these reasons that I am naming Lee Tammy this year's Employee of the Year. Aww. of a data program that has caught national attention has become the envy of major cities across the country. Congratulations, Lee, and thank you for your service. Better customer service this year has meant finally putting to rest the fight over the sewer district. Over the course of several months, Vice Mayor David Mann and I worked with County Commissioner Denise Treehouse and County Commission President Todd Portu to come to an agreement regarding the leadership and administration of the sewer district. This would not have been possible without collaboration and help of Judge Barrett and hard work. This resulted in an agreement that allows the city to move forward in partnership with the county to run MSD in a way to the utmost benefit of the people of the whole county. It also saves more than $5 million a year in litigation and monitoring and duplicative costs that will help fix the sewers. And most importantly, it saves the city pension system, which was a critical goal for the city. By collaborating rather than litigating, we have put the public interest ahead of political turf wars. Solving this problem and rebuilding our financial foundation has allowed us to deal with other important issues to build a more progressive city. It is in that spirit we are taking meaningful action to combat climate change. I have signed a pledge to commit the city of Cincinnati to use 100% renewable energy by 2035, and I fully intend to take action to get as close to that goal as I can before I leave office. In fact, we just proposed this week a plan to add solar panels to our airport at Lunkin. Denver Airport has solar panels throughout its airport. There's no reason why we can't at Lunkin. And at our waterworks and at other city facilities to provide 25 megawatts of renewable energy. This is a $50 million project that will be the largest on-site municipal solar project in the country. The 25 megawatt solar arrays will produce approximately 33 million kilowatts hours, enough electricity to power 3,400 homes. This will reduce the city's carbon emissions by 25,000 tons annually, which is the equivalent of removing 5,000 cars from the road, planting 600,000 trees, and keeping 24 million pounds of coal in the ground per year. And equally important, it will save ratepayer money. Let me be clear about that. It will save ratepayer money. Once we buy it and build it, it's free. The question is whether the cost of paying off the purchase is more or less than the current cost of energy. Because of federal tax credits and depreciation that's available in 2019, until then, it is literally cheaper to do it if you have a project big enough of this size. And so we want to rush to both help the environment and help the ratepayer by getting these solar arrays up before 2019. We are also leading the effort to upgrade the Green Cincinnati Plan to establish goals and strategies to significantly reduce greenhouse gas emissions and improve our local economy, public health, and quality of life. Under the leadership of Larry Falcon and his team, Ollie Kroner, and Michael Forrester, Cincinnati is a leader in fighting climate change. In the last 9 years, the citywide emissions are down 18% and government emissions down 36%. And we are making record strides in building up our neighborhoods. Over the last year, we have doubled down on our commitment to ensure that all Cincinnatians in every neighborhood have the opportunity to share in our city's renewed prosperity. Last year, we recommitted the proceeds of the sale of the Blue Ash Airport to neighborhoods, $40 million. And we are seeing many of those projects come to life. In Avondale, this month, we will break ground on a transformative mixed-use development, including a health clinic for the neighborhood. The design of the Westwood Town Square has been complete, and we will see that vision break ground in the spring. Our colleague and good friend, Councilmember Amy Murray, has guided the Washington Way Bike Trail through its first phase that will be completed this June. And after that, we'll cross I-71 on its own bridge and land at the door of Xavier University in the educated neighborhood of Evanston. Thank you, Amy Murray, for your leadership. And these are just a few examples. Just 2 weeks ago, council members Kevin Flynn, David Mann, and P.G. Sittenfeld, and let's take a second to thank thank Kevin Flynn for his service on City Council. We know he won't be coming back as a council member by his choice, but we wish he was. P.G. Sittenfeld, David Mann, and myself introduced and created a new fund that will allow neighborhoods to invest a whole new stream of revenue back into their neighborhoods on priorities that the neighborhoods set for themselves. In the long run, this program will provide millions of dollars to further neighborhood development. But perhaps nothing speaks more to our city's renaissance than the pride of Cincinnati. I walked into this on pride, but in this case, I'm talking about beer. From Westwood to College Hill to Evanston to the East End, breweries have become central to neighborhood development. As I've said many times in recent weeks, beer is bringing back our neighborhoods.
What inspired us to open a brewery on Hamilton Avenue was we were all born and raised Cincinnati boys, and we really wanted to connect to the city's brewing heritage. So,
as cheesy as it might sound, the Pleasant Ridge is the best kept secret of our people. I think we've been most surprised by is how much Pleasant Ridge has loved their community. They've been massively supportive of us and the other businesses that have opened here recently.
What inspired us to open here locally on Madison Road was the fact that two and a half years into this process, we were kind of busting at the seams, trying to make enough beer for the city, for the neighborhood. We found a great opportunity here on Madison Road. The magic actually started here at Oakley, so we've always considered Oakley as our backyard.
So we really want to get involved in OCR. And it was important to us to be a part of the growth of OCR. It's such a great history here, breweries, stores,
The reason that happened at OCR to try to become part of this amazing community that was basically being redeveloped, bringing new energy down to the center of the city and encouraging the citizens from the other areas.
It's been unbelievable. The community support we've received has been tremendous, and I think we've been great for the community, but it goes the other way also. The community's been great for us, and we rely on the support of the community, and we're just a small piece of what's going on. We see other businesses open, other businesses in the works, and I think that's all a result of not what we're doing, but what the city's doing with the park across the street and other efforts.
Being a part of the brewing industry is fantastic. It's really the brotherhood amongst people that should be competitors. I don't really know another business where you can call someone that's supposed to be your competitor and say you're short on materials that they have to eat tomorrow. And immediately they say yes, and they even drive it over to you. So they'll leave you short on some grain. Matthew's the closest brewery we love to call them. They have grain for us where we're really that day. So we really don't know another industry that's good like that. So it's something that makes the brewing industry so unique and special.
Our logo is Phoenix, and for us, the Phoenix represents rebirth of the neighborhood of this building, which was built in 1909. It's a nonfiction house, and really the rebirth of craft brewing in Cincinnati. There's so much that's changed in the last even 5 years. We felt the Phoenix and the symbol and the character of rebirth is really important.
Looking back over the past year and what's going on before our 1 year anniversary and the celebration of our 1 year anniversary, I just feel so blessed by the community and by the people that have supported us, because this did not happen. Just us, just the Hughes family and just the brewers and just our employees. This is all the people in the community that love Streetside and want to support us.
Yeah, I just did a video about beer drinking during the State of the Citizens. You know what they say, honey, you can take the boy out of Bryce Hill, but you can't take the Bryce Hill. As our economy is growing, we are experiencing a renaissance that has lifted the spirits of our city, pun intended. We are working hard to extend that success to everyone in Cincinnati and to close disparities within our city. In 2013, when I took office, the city spent roughly $4 million a year with African-American-owned businesses, representing less than 3% of total spending. I vowed that we would change that and get it to at least 15% in 4 years. And while there is more to be achieved, our city has made great progress in surpassing that goal, getting 17% or $19.6 million last year to African-American-owned businesses in 2016. This does not account for the additional $25 million, roughly, in commitments we have secured through negotiating economic inclusion elements of private sector deals that we do on a regular basis. Like you, I believe we still have much more ground to cover to truly increase the equity in our city, but we are making progress. I do want to thank Markia Carter for her leadership at the Office of Economic Development. We are making real strides in reducing poverty and expanding opportunity. Poverty is coming down. Last year, our city moved 4,000 people out of poverty, a 1.5% decrease. That is modest, but proof that efforts of many efforts around the city, including our Hand Up initiative, are working. With partner organizations such as the Urban League, the Community Action Agency, Cincinnati Cooks, Cincinnati Works, and many others, too many to list, the Hand Up initiative is putting low-income Cincinnatians back to work at living wage jobs. Over the last 3 years, this program has placed 550 people in jobs and provided 1,000 people with the job training skills they need. This year, more than ever, our budget reflected our values with continued investment in human services, which collectively we have tripled since we took office in 2013. This year, thanks to Councilmember Simpson's leadership, we increased funding by $350,000. Let's thank Councilmember Simpson. Outside of City Hall, we are also working to close disparities in healthcare. Under the leadership of the First Ladies of several dozen churches, my wife, Deanna Cranley, and her co-chair, Barbara Lynch, of New Jerusalem Baptist Church, are leading the Third Annual First Ladies for Health Family Health Day this Sunday, October 8th. In the last 2 years, over 4,000 people have been served by this initiative. The First Ladies for Health is a volunteer group that educates and connects our community with resources to help them take charge of their own health. This year, this Sunday, 16 host locations will provide free health screenings and other health-related services. More than 45 community partners and 800 volunteers are involved with this effort. Let's give my wife the First Lady and Barbara a round of applause.
Very, very proud.
We've seen a lot of progress in tackling disparities, health disparities, and poverty. But I think it's fair to say that over the course of this last year, and I always try to look back and think, what was the most significant thing that happened in the course of this city? The single greatest advance to reduce poverty over the last year was the passage of the preschool promise. Research shows. Research shows that children who receive quality preschool are more likely to be ready for kindergarten, to read by the third grade, and to graduate. But until the preschool promise, many of our children living in poverty were not able to access affordable quality preschool, which perpetuated cycles and generational cycles of poverty. We must ensure that children have the same educational opportunities, regardless of background, which is why our city voted for the preschool promise that is now being implemented. The vision and the determination to convince this community to adopt the preschool promise was not easy. It was a very hard job. But Greg Lansman and Stephanie Bird dedicated literally years of their lives to this cause because fundamentally they want to leave this city better than they found it. And they have. And that's why I am giving them the Cincinnati of the Year Award. Thank you, Greg and Stephanie, for being here. Thank you. This year, we will continue the work of the Child Poverty Collaborative. My fellow co-chairs, Odell Nolan, Sister Sally Duffy, Michael Fisher, Donna Jones-Baker, Tom Williams, and I, along with a very active steering committee of more than 30 people, have committed ourselves to this very important issue. The goal of this initiative is to, at a local level, figure out how to reduce the poverty rate in a meaningful way for children and families.
We have an opportunity to change the outcomes in our city, and it's going to take all of us to make this happen. So I invite anybody and everybody to come out and be a part of this process.
This initiative is different than any other initiative because we're directly involving the people in the community that it's going to affect.
We're going to be a vibrant region with a lot of economic opportunity that boasts where people want to move here, corporations want to move here. We've got to tackle this issue head on.
I think that if we knew the answers, we would have already done them. That's the kind of city that we are, and that's the kind of community that we are. But I think we need to look at this in a different way.
Here I am, a little small person, getting involved and, you know, just giving back with just being me.
We can't solve problems from a distance. And I think that if anyone is skeptical, I encourage them to get closer to the process and people in the process.
Let people know that there is a different way that we can do this if we all work together.
We are open, we are in a learning process, and we expect everybody to be willing and open to learn as well with us.
I want people in my congregation and the individuals that they're connected to understand the seriousness of it, that it's not somebody else's problem.
It's very important to me for the people who are in poverty to have their voice to understand their situation.
What is it that we intend to do, and how do we make sure the things that we intend to do are meaningful and effective?
By reaching out to people in the community, we're letting them know, like, hey, we want to involve you. You mean something to this effort, and the only way that we can do this is with you. We basically cannot move forward with change in poverty without your input, because at the end of the day, you guys are the ones that are living in this.
Child Poverty Collaborative has selected 28 community agencies to participate in a major strategic initiative that lifts 10,000 children out of poverty. This effort, known as the One-to-One Learning Collaborative, is a new way for organizations to work together to better leverage the many interventions already in place. Agencies already supporting families in our community have agreed to work together to create a deep, personalized, and comprehensive support network capable of addressing any number of barriers that hold people back. Barriers such as reliable child care, safe and affordable housing, transportation, job skills training, health challenges, and more. This approach includes supporting families over time to continue to provide support when new or recurring issues emerge. The process involves coaching or mentoring families to understand their goals and then design approaches that can be tested and measured to identify the solutions provide real impact. By learning together, the agencies will go further, faster in supporting families. The CPC is also bringing our area's largest employers together in the Employer Roundtable to implement voluntary reforms to employment practices that help people keep the jobs, improve retention, and help people earn their way into the middle class and take care of their families. And our work to reduce poverty is reaching new heights, and today is an historic day effort for two reasons. One, we want to thank the incredible leadership of Lynn Marmer over the last 2 years to get us as far as we have. And let's give Lynn Marmer a round of applause. She has become a friend and she has made a huge difference. And today we announce Karen Bankston to take over as the Executive Director of the Child Poverty Director as its new Director. Karen couldn't be here tonight, but she is a superstar, and she's already hit the ground running. It's going to be an exciting year together. In the coming year, we will implement the One-to-One Child Poverty Collaborative and go from being a leader in poverty and child poverty to a leader in poverty reduction. In the coming year, we will continue our policies that welcome job growth and work to help people earn living wage jobs. In the coming year, we will work to expand public transit In fact, we will be working with the Chamber to explore innovative options to integrate various modes of transportation to address gaps in service, improve ease of use, and connect people to jobs. In the coming year, we will forge partnerships to align every entity in our city that holds a stake in keeping Cincinnati clean and beautiful. And we're putting together a task force spearheaded by the very energetic and very serious about ending litter. In fact, she wants to obliterate litter. Nora Fink. Let's give her a round of applause. We will be working with Keep Cincinnati Beautiful and many other partners to make the city of Cincinnati shine as the Queen should. In the coming year, we will see through our investments in solar and help homeowners retrofit their homes to reduce demand on greenhouse gases and save on their energy bills. This city is making progress because we are bringing in major new jobs like GE, Children's, and Kroger. And the progress of our city is progressive because we are working to reduce poverty, close racial disparities, invest in clean, renewable energy, and spreading good times, hint, beer, and places back into our neighborhoods. Our city's comeback will be judged not just by how high our skyline of new buildings reach, but how well we reach and lift the bottom of our city up to new opportunities. The greatest privilege I have as mayor is to ask people to give back to our city. And all of our greatest accomplishments over the last several years has resulted from just asking people to give back to this city we all love. From the pension agreement to our inclusion success, to the collaborative refresh, to welcoming immigrants, the Child Poverty Collaborative, resolving the fight over MSD, the CRA legislation, working on renewable solar energy, all of those efforts have come from reaching out, talking, and working through problems together. People work together when they don't have to, but do because of love of city, because somebody asked. And it is in this spirit that I am issuing a challenge tonight to each and every Cincinnatian. I am asking all Cincinnatians in 2018 to give 1 hour for Cincinnati, 1 hour each month, to help those in our community who need it most. So I'm asking everyone to do at least 1 hour a month to help someone learn to read, to teach someone the skills they need to help clean up litter. Give one for Cincinnati. Just 1 hour a month can go a long way. And if you can give more than an hour, obviously that's great. There are lots of children in this community that CYC and Big Brothers and Big Sisters that need mentors. It's a major time commitment, and I'm not suggesting everyone be open to it. But I can promise you this, if you start giving back, it tends to be contagious, and you tend to do more. But if each of us gives just 1 hour a month, think of the extraordinary changes we can bring to our city. Cumulatively, our thousands of hours of service can make a positive difference to our young people, in our neighborhoods, in our schools, and in all of our community. And we can have fun encouraging each other along the way. Tonight, I'm announcing a task force of several citywide volunteer organizations listed above, and there are many others, but all of these individuals have already agreed to serve on a task force to report back to us all by Thanksgiving on how we can track, encourage, and have friendly competition in giving back in 2018. In December, we will finalize this Give One for Cincy plan and launch the Give Back Year of 2018. If your organization wants to be part of this task force, please let us know. We're not trying to leave anybody out. And contact us through the mayor's office website. So let us rejoice in our success over the past year and toast, last beer reference of the night, to the coming challenges of the next year. I know we can meet these challenges together by giving back to the city we love. Thank you very much. Have a great evening.